It is my pleasure to welcome the first speaker, David Katz from Yale University. And David, we're really excited about the topic that you're about to give. How can we best reverse the obesity and diabetes epidemic? Can you please tell us how to reverse this epidemic?
Thank you very much, Hannah. I guess I should say Hanka, which I didn't know. I am delighted, however, that Hannah said good morning in the afternoon, because I know how to say good morning in Czech. Dobré ráno. I have no idea how to say good afternoon in Czech, so it works for me. So good morning in the afternoon. Dobré ráno. The video was entirely unfair, because Prague is a ridiculously hard act to follow. I am really delighted to be here in this magnificent city. I'm especially delighted to see friends from all around the world, and that much more so to be here with my beautiful wife, and very impressed with myself and my wife that we managed to get three of our five children here, because as those of you with grown children know, rallying the troops gets ever more difficult, right? So we got three of them together. The five of us are here in Prague. And frankly, I think that should be mission accomplished. Except that Hannah gave me 20 minutes to reverse the epidemics of obesity and diabetes, which seems a bit of a challenge. Anyway, that was the question put to me. How do we reverse the obesity and diabetes epidemic? And I would say we do it like this. See, Hannah might have asked, how do we get to the moon? It would have seemed a far loftier ambition than reversing these pedestrian epidemics of obesity and diabetes, right? How do we get to the moon? But of course, we all know humanity has done exactly that. There are footprints on the moon. There is a flag on the moon. And the answer to the question, how do we get to the moon, is, as best I can tell, three things. The first really is desire. We want it to go. The second is ingenuity. We are a relentless, ingenious species, and when we want something badly enough, I pity the fool that gets in our way. But the third critical ingredient, I think, for getting where we want to go, is knowing where that is. You cannot get there from here unless you acknowledge where there is. There was no dissent about where to find the moon. There were no competing theories about alternative moons. We should go this way, we should go that way, that's not really the moon. Everything you've ever heard about the moon is false. And yet with regard to the application of diet as the medicine it might be for the masses, that's exactly the confusion that we tend to propagate all the time. So, in the 20 minutes I have, how do we reverse the epidemics of obesity and diabetes? Just like this. We decide we want to do it, we apply our ingenuity and relentless pertinacity, and we rally around the fact that we know exactly where there is, what the application of lifestyle as medicine would look like. But I can tell you one thing, we don't do it like we are doing it. No offense to those in the room. Inevitably, at a gathering such as this, you preach to the converted. You all know what needs to be done. But it's the masses we must get to follow us, and we are failing in that enterprise. A full issue of the Journal of the American Medical Association recently was devoted to trends in obesity. So I have 20 minutes to reverse the obesity epidemic, but the most recent epidemiologic data we have indicate that it is continuing to worsen. Obesity rates have at best leveled off in men in the United States. They probably continue to rise, and severe obesity certainly continues to rise in men. Obesity rates continue to rise significantly in women in the United States, and we, by the way, are the harbinger for what is to come in developed countries all around the world. We're bigger, we're badder, our situation is worse, but we're all in the same sinking boat together. And the trends in children and adolescents, ominously, despite all that we've done to direct attention to the epidemics of obesity and diabetes in young people, continue to worsen. We don't fix the obesity and diabetes epidemics like this. I would contend that at the level of culture, those of us in Hanka's crew, the anti-obesity crew, the anti-diabetes crew, are bailing this sinking ship with pipettes while our culture at large is flooding the boat with a fire hose. There is Coca-Cola for sale everywhere all the time in the United States. There is a McDonald's on every street corner. Food is marketed continuously throughout the day. And in this age, when we fret about the routine diagnosis of what used to be adult onset diabetes in children, type 2 diabetes, we continue to market, and I mean this quite literally, multicolored marshmallows as part of a complete breakfast. Those are the forces that oppose our efforts to reverse the obesity and diabetes epidemics in the 20 minutes that we have. Since I took over as president of the American College of Lifestyle Medicine, I've been talking about what I think is the greater proposition in the choice of prepositions. There is lifestyle in medicine, and there is lifestyle as medicine. Much of the focus of our college is on lifestyle in medicine, effective counseling and programs overseen by clinicians and doctors to do just what the mission is here today, to better treat, prevent, reverse obesity, diabetes, all of the related cardiometabolic disorders. But I think the greater proposition is for us to be the tip of the spear, for us to be at the vanguard of culture change, so that the requisite medicine is all around us, and people simply need a whole lot less medicine in the first place. We know full well what lifestyle could do. And I think for purposes of this discussion here, what's particularly salient is that we have known full well what lifestyle could do and what lifestyle could do it for literal decades. In fact, I have been admonished recently for only going back 23 years to 1993, because this literature, in fact, goes back further. But in 1993, McGinnis and Feige published Actual Causes of Death in the United States. And my apologies for any semblance of ethnocentrism. This isn't about the United States. The United States really, as noted, is simply an emblem for the plight of the modern, westernized, developed world. We invented many of these problems, but we don't own them anymore. They have been globally disseminated. What McGinnis and Feige said was that the things that show up on death certificates, heart disease, cancer, stroke, diabetes, etc., those aren't actually the causes of premature death, because they're not causes at all, they are effects. And what they did in this seminal paper is enumerate effects of what? And the answer was a list of 10 factors that underlie all of those chronic diseases that routinely take years from lives and life from years, diabetes prominent on the list. And for our purposes here today, although that full list of 10 factors is quite interesting, let's just focus on the first three things. Because the first three things on McGinnis and Feige's list back in 1993 accounted for fully 80% of the premature deaths each year in the United States. And those three things were tobacco use, poor diet, and lack of physical activity. And that middle one is important here today, because that means in 1993, we were able to define poor diet and attribute a massive proportion of chronic disease and premature death to it directly. The only thing wrong with this paper is how old it is and how little has happened since. But if you think this is the only evidence of this issue, it is not. 10 years later, this was reanalyzed by the CDC. Same conclusion. The only thing that had changed in the span of that first decade is that the gap between tobacco as the number one cause of premature death and the combination of bad use of feet and forks as number two had narrowed, because we were all smoking a bit less, at least in the States, but also because our diets had deteriorated further, ever less physical activity. And by the way, I characterize these first three things on McGinnis and Feige's list for ease of memory as bad use of feet, forks, and fingers. And these are things we can fix, right? We know that when you flip the switch, you get exactly the results you would hope for. This study by Earl Ford and colleagues published in 2009 looked at 23,000 adults in and around Potsdam, Germany, so we've left the United States now. And what they did was ask people about four factors. They ask, do you smoke, yes or no? Do you eat a healthy diet, yes or no? And interesting, given all the debate about diet, they were able to define a healthy diet as habitual intake of vegetables, fruits, and whole grains, and that was sufficient. Sufficient for what? Well, I'll tell you in just a second. But they asked, do you smoke, yes or no? Do you eat well, yes or no? Are you physically active on a regular basis, yes or no? And do you have a healthy weight, yes or no? And then they compared the two ends of the spectrum. They compared, I don't smoke, I eat well, I'm active, my weight is fine. Do I smoke, eat badly, don't exercise, my weight's not so good? These people had an 80% lesser incidence over the span of the study of all major chronic disease than these people. So yes, diabetes, but also heart disease, cancer, stroke, dementia. 80% less of all of the slings and arrows of outrageous epidemiologic misfortune, if you will. Flip the switch on any of these from bad to good, and the probability of developing any major chronic disease generally goes down about 50%. But fire on all four cylinders. Don't smoke, eat well, be active, and as a result, mostly of eating well and being active, have your weight about where it ought to be. Reduce your risk of ever developing not just diabetes, but any major chronic disease by about 80%. These findings have been reaffirmed around the world, in the UK a few years ago, in the US more recently still, and I contend that this is one of the more impressive, consistent drumbeats in all of the peer-reviewed literature, with reaffirmation of just these findings again and again and again, and specifically with regard to diabetes, the focus here. Well, we all know about the diabetes prevention program. I noticed over there the poster for glucophage, or metformin, and we should acknowledge our thanks for the sponsorship and note that metformin is an excellent drug for type 2 diabetes, and as Naller and colleagues were the first to show, it's actually an excellent drug for diabetes prevention as well. Use of metformin reduce the incidence of type 2 diabetes in high-risk adults by a very impressive 30% in the diabetes prevention program. But our mission here today isn't about good pharmacotherapy, it's about good diets. The lifestyle intervention component of the diabetes prevention program reduced the incidence of type 2 diabetes, the very mission I have to fulfill in 20 minutes, reversed the epidemic of diabetes, if you will, by 58%. It was twice as effective as one of the best drugs we have. Admittedly, metformin is one of the best drugs we have, but lifestyle's better. 58% reduction in incident diabetes. What did they do? Did they wave a magic wand at people? No, the prescription was a moderate, balanced, mostly plant-based diet. It wasn't vegetarian or vegan. It wasn't extreme. It was just a heck of a lot better than the typical American diet. Routine physical activity, on average a 7% reduction in body weight, and a 58% reduction in incident diabetes. People did not get diabetes two times in three, nearly, because lifestyle was the medicine it could be universally. And the implications of lifestyle reverberate to within the double helix of DNA itself. This is off the topic of diabetes, but germane just the same. A study by my friend Dean Ornish and colleagues, they enrolled 30 men with early stage prostate cancer, and rather than just watch and wait and see whether or not the cancer progressed and required conventional treatment, they gave these men lifestyle as medicine. So an optimal plant-based diet, routine physical activity, obviously no tobacco, and in addition, plenty of good sleep, dissipation of stress, strong social interactions, or as I like to call these things, feet, forks, fingers, sleep, stress, and love. That is the six-cylinder engine, if you will, of lifestyle as medicine. They fired on all six, and over a span of months, studied not so much the men and not so much the cancer in the men, but preferentially the genes in the men with the cancer, and here's what they found. 500 cancer promoter genes were dramatically downregulated, and shown here, 50 cancer suppressor genes. Red is off, green is on, left is before, right is after, were dramatically upregulated. The power of lifestyle, inclusive of a plant-based diet, is such that it can refashion our fate at the very level of our genes. And this is not just one study, it's a whole branch of the literature. So at the height of our enthusiasm for the genomic age, we may have thought that DNA was destiny. It's not for diabetes, not for any other adverse outcome. There are rare instances, of course, sickle cell anemia, Huntington's disease, but by and large, to a far greater extent than our culture tends to appreciate, dinner is destiny. Because dinner can throw the epigenetic switches that change what our genes do. Not only that, but dinner and lifestyle can reshape the very composition of our chromosomes, lengthening our telomeres when we get things right, shortening them when we get things wrong. And as I trust you all know, the best marker in all of biology of how long our lives will be is how long our telomeres are. And we have demonstrated, we being the scientific community at large, not me, we have demonstrated that lifestyle can alter the length of telomeres in work that actually earned Elizabeth Blackburn a Nobel Prize. So the master levers of medical destiny are not anything residing in the modern pharmacopoeia. They're nothing being generated at the advancing edge of biotechnology. The master levers of medical destiny, the power to reverse epidemics of obesity and diabetes, reside in what we do each day with our feet, our forks, and our fingers. Because after all, you know what Archimedes said about a lever: give me one long enough and I can move the whole world. These are the levers long enough to move the whole world of modern epidemiology to a better place. But alas, we like to say knowledge is power. Would that it were so. Clearly it's not. The gap between what we know and what we do with what we know belies that wishful thinking. For after all, we have known since 1993 at least how to prevent 80% of all chronic disease and premature death, and the opportunity to do that has been squandered in the failure to translate knowledge into the power of routine action. So we find ourselves a long way from where we need to be in a world to which we are badly maladapted. It may make it feel as if you just can't get there from here, but remember the moon. I would argue we have to wrestle with another problem first. Do we in fact know and agree where there is? It's prerequisite. Well, with regard to fingers, smoking is worse than not smoking. Anyone at all confused or want to push back on that issue? There's no good academic debate about that one. Delighted to find that out. Feet, using them good, walking up and down this magnificent hill in Prague is excellent. Not using them, not so good. Sitting on our butts in a conference room all day, not nearly as good. We all agree about that too, right? But forks, there's the rub. We hear about a new way to eat right every damn day. And everybody who comes along to tell us throws everybody who came before under the bus. So we are perpetually confused about how best to feed Homo sapiens. And these days, of course, there's particular focus on saturated fat. Allegedly, we're all very confused about saturated fat because we have evidence that when we ate a bit less of it, things didn't get better. But I trust you all know that if indeed we ever ate a bit less saturated fat, we did not replace it with lentils and kale. If we did that at all and replaced it with anything, we replaced it with Snackwell cookies. Is anyone shocked to learn that effectively low-fat junk food did not make us all slim and healthy? No real revelation there, right? And in fact, that very issue has been examined. So although everybody tends to cite the Siri Torino meta-analysis from 2010 or the Chowdhury meta-analysis from 2014 to exonerate saturated fat, the study that really matters is this one by Lee et al. At Harvard, who asked the critical question, if people do cut their sat fat calories, what replaces those calories? So in 85,000 people over 20 years, they looked preferentially at those who reduced their intake of saturated fat, and they asked what replaced it. When sat fat calories were replaced with trans fat calories, things went from bad to worse, no surprise. When sat fat calories were replaced by added sugars and highly refined carbohydrate, such as reducing pepperoni and eating Snackwell cookies instead, things stayed exactly comparably bad. Equal rates of cardiovascular and cardiometabolic disease both times. The evidence actually seems to indicate that an excess of saturated fat from the usual sources, pastrami and pepperoni and processed dairy products, for example, is exactly as bad as added sugar. If, however, saturated fat calories were replaced with either whole grain calories or unsaturated fat calories from the nuts and seeds we'll be hearing about in the next session, olives, avocado, olive oil, fish, and seafood, dramatic and statistically significant reductions in cardiometabolic disease, which frankly is what I think we thought we knew 20 minutes ago before we all became confused about saturated fat, right? The answer is entirely confluent not only with the weight of scientific evidence, but with sense. Science is not a substitute for sense, nor is any single study, let alone wild misinterpretations of it, an alternative to understanding the weight of the evidence. And reality check, all this argument about we should have been focused on sugar, not saturated fat, we were focused on sugar all the time. Whoever said we were obligated to choose between salami and sugar? Maybe both are the problem. The first iteration of the Dietary Guidelines for Americans came out in 1980, just about 40 years ago. There were 7 highlighted priorities. Number 5 was to eat less sugar. This was not discovered by somebody in the news last Tuesday. We've been talking about this for 40 years. The problem is nobody's doing it. And by the way, nobody's reducing their intake of anything. The evidence we have, both on the dietary intake side and on the food consumption side from USDA and NHANES in the US, indicate that the only reason it looks like we reduced our percent calories from fat is because we increased our total calories. You know, there's 2 ways to shrink a ratio. Shrink the numerator or grow the denominator. Guess which we chose? We grew the denominator. If we eat more calories, our percent calories from fat will go down, right? So we didn't stop eating pepperoni to start eating Snapwells. We ate the pepperoni and then had the Snapwells for dessert. And in fact, not only do we know that that's what's going on, but we have good information about trends in specific food groups over the last 40 years. I highly recommend to you this flow diagram on Vox.com. So if you just Google American, don't have to write this whole URL, but just Google Vox, American diet changes, it'll bring you to this landing page, and it actually shows by category of food the trends over a 40-year period. And it is quite arresting. We even know why we're eating more. Michael Moss, who's a Pulitzer Prize-winning investigative journalist, has written about the fact that all of the big food companies in the U.S. hire teams of scientists who work together using functional MRI machines with marching orders to design food we can't stop eating. And he wrote this New York Times Magazine cover story, The Extraordinary Science of Addictive Junk Food. His book, which I commend to you all, is Salt, Sugar, Fat. So the typical American diet looks just like it has always looked. It glows in the dark. So take this all home, turn out the light, it's a wonderful show. And it brings us to a fork in the road. Along one tine, we remain forever befuddled at the level of our culture about the basic care and feeding of Homo sapiens. I'd like to propose an alternative. If we look from altitude at the evidence for or against low-fat diets, vegan diets, low-glycemic diets, the DASH diet, which we'll hear about at this conference, the diabetes prevention program already mentioned, paleo diets, low-carb diets, the Mediterranean diet, I think it's probably best to leave out the Twinkie diet, but all of the reasonable diets, if we look from altitude as I and many others have done, what our culture is telling people every day is why my diet can beat your diet. And since that news keeps changing, people remain confused and don't change anything. What really matters is what makes all good diets alike, not what makes them different. That olive in the middle, pretty nicely skewered by Michael Pollan, when he said, eat food, not too much, mostly plants, which admittedly leaves a fair amount to the imagination. But that's all right. It's a broad theme we really can rely on. And frankly, much the same message was spelled out in considerably greater detail in the 572 excellent pages of the Dietary Guidelines Advisory Committee report. Not the official Dietary Guidelines, that's politicized gobbledygook. But the 2015 Dietary Guideline Advisory Committee report in the U.S. is outstanding. It's online. I highly commend it to you. And when Walter Willett and I were privileged to co-chair a conference about the common ground of healthy eating in Boston last November, sponsored by Old Ways, and some of the same folks who are in this room were there at the time, we reached the same basic conclusion. We don't agree about every last detail, but we certainly agree that a diet of mostly minimally processed plant foods, vegetables, fruits, whole grains, beans, lentils, nuts, seeds, water when thirsty, if we mostly all did that, man, that would fix a lot of problems. And one of the beauties of all of this is it fixes problems beyond our own skin. So I actually will take Hanka's impossible mission to reverse the epidemics of obesity and diabetes in 20 minutes, and I will up the ante. Let's reverse climate change into the bargain. Let's save this beautiful planet of ours. Let's preserve biodiversity, because a plant-based diet of minimally processed foods offers us the opportunity to do that as well. There is a wonderful confluence in the application of lifestyle as medicine for ourselves and medicine at this critical juncture for our ailing planet. So we know that lifestyle is the very best of medicine. The challenge in my final minutes then is, how do we get this medicine to go down? I trust you're all familiar with the Mary Poppins prescription, but Lord knows the last thing we need now is more spoons full of sugar. I would argue we need some kind of spoon to get the medicine to go down. And frankly, since this is a big issue, we need a big spoon. And I contend that lifestyle is the medicine and culture is the spoon, not clinics. Yes, we clinicians, physicians and others, scientists have a role to play at the tip of the spear. But our job, if we are to reverse the epidemics, is to lead a cultural revolution so that we embrace health, that we agree on where the destination is. And the evidence we have of what culture can do emanates from the world's blue zones, described by Dan Buettner, those five places around the world where people most routinely live to be 100 and never get chronic disease. Sardinia, Italy, Ikaria, Greece, Okinawa, Japan, the Seventh-day Adventist in Loma Linda, California, and the folks on the Nicoya Peninsula in Costa Rica. They're wonderfully heterogeneous. They eat a high-fat Mediterranean diet in Ikaria and Sardinia. They eat a vegetarian or mostly vegetarian or even vegan diet in Loma Linda, California. They eat a low-fat traditional Asian diet in Okinawa. They eat a middle-of-the-road omnivorous diet in the Nicoya Peninsula. But in every instance, they eat diets of minimally processed, mostly plant foods, drink water when thirsty, they're physically active. By and large, they don't smoke, they get plenty of sleep, they're not stressed out, and they have a strong sense of community. Feet, forks, fingers, sleep, stress, and love every time. They do not have obesity and diabetes epidemics. They are the shining beacon on the hill of what is possible. And we also know that it's possible to administer this medicine. It's not just where it springs up naturally, but in North Karelia, Finland, at the middle of the 20th century, they had some of the highest rates of premature cardiovascular disease anywhere in the world. Pekka Puska and others decided to use what we knew way back then about lifestyle as medicine, initiated a community-wide intervention to get people to stop smoking, eat less animal foods, eat more plant-based, and the result over the last 40 years is a stunning 82% reduction in the prevalence of cardiovascular disease and a 10-year addition to life expectancy itself. More years in life, more life in years, lifestyle is the medicine. Everywhere other than North Karelia, I feel as if the House of Public Health has been on fire these decades, and we, the firefighters, are standing with our backs to the blaze, arguing over who's got the best hose, because that's what we do when we confuse the public about which diet is better than which diet, instead of rallying around the common ground of what we know. And as we argue over who's got the best hose, none of us turns around to spray a drop and the building burns to the ground. But this building is public health. This building is years and lives and life in years. I say let's turn around, put out the fire, and once it's out and everybody's saved, let's figure out who's got the best hose. Maybe there is a better way to put out a fire. But the time to argue over that is after we've put out the fire, not while the house is ablaze. To address this very issue then, my modest contribution to this global effort is something called the True Health Coalition. It's an effort to pull together a who's who in the world of public health, nutrition, and I'm proud to say there are members of the council in this very room who are willing to stand together in public and say, we agree. I may be vegan, I may advocate for a Mediterranean diet, I may even be paleo, I may be all about sustainability, I may be all about diabetes, I may be all about cancer, but we agree about the fundamental prescription of lifestyle as medicine, and we're willing to stand up in public and be counted because we think that agreement has the power to change the world. And if what I'm saying here in the short time I have makes sense, I invite you all to join us. Add your voice to this global chorus, check out who's on the council already, sign up, because in unity is the strength required to fulfill the mission that Hanka assigned me. For far too long in our culture, we have let health languish on the road not traveled. I think we'd all like to see it on a path of lesser resistance. I think in order to do that, we have to first see the big picture. And to get there, in the final 2 minutes of my talk, I brought along six friends to help me. It was six men of Indistan, to learning much inclined, who went to see the elephant, though all of them were blind, that each by observation might satisfy his mind. The first approached the elephant, and happening to fall against his broad and sturdy side, at once began to bawl, "God bless me, but the elephant is very like a wall." The second, feeling of the tusk, cried, "Ho, what have we here? So very round and smooth and sharp, to meet 'tis mighty clear, this wonder of an elephant is very like a spear." The third approached the animal, and happening to take the squirming trunk within his hands, thus boldly up and spake, "I see," quoth he, "the elephant is very like a snake." The fourth reached out an eager hand and felt about the knee. "What most this wondrous beast is like is mighty plain," quoth he, "'tis clear enough the elephant is very like a tree." The fifth, who chanced to touch the ear, said, "E'en the blindest man can tell what this resembles most. Deny the fact who can. This marvel of an elephant is very like a fan." The sixth no sooner had begun about the beast to grope than, seizing on the swinging tail that fell within his scope, "I see," quoth he, "the elephant is very like a rope." And so these men of Indistan disputed loud and long, each in his own opinion, exceeding stiff and strong, though each was partly in the right and all were in the wrong. So oft in theologic wars the disputants, I ween, rail on in utter ignorance of what each other mean, and prate about the elephant not one of them has seen. My friends, I fear we're prone to much the same tendency in epidemiology, nutritional epidemiology in particular. But there is a beautiful opportunity before us to escape the dark wood of modern epidemiology by seeing the forest through the trees, by seeing past the disassembled parts to the entire elephant in the room. Because in the strength of our unity, if we get behind and push, we can move it. We can add years to lives and life to years. Yes, absolutely, we can reverse the epidemics of obesity and diabetes. We can, in fact, accomplish for public health something that is out of this world. Thank you all very much.
Thank you very much, David. Now the mission impossible seems, at least sounds doable or even simple. Thank you very much for your talk. And it's my pleasure to invite our second speaker, Professor Terena Tonstad from Norway, from Oslo University Hospital, who became famous for her work on the Adventist Health Study, analyzing the data on diabetes incidence and showing that vegetarians have low risk of diabetes. So Serena will give her talk on vegetarian diets in the prevention of diabetes.
Good afternoon, everyone. I'm really happy to be here. This is probably my third or fourth time in Prague, and it seems more beautiful than ever, thanks to you, Hannah, and the organizers. So I come to you from Oslo University Hospital and from Loma Linda University, and my topic is vegetarian diets in the prevention of diabetes. Obviously, a lot of the data that we'll be looking at is observational evidence, and so I'll take you back to the first evidence. We'll go through as fast as we can through what has accumulated through the years, and then we'll look at some of the mechanisms that may be involved. So the initial study, at least the initial one that I know about in regard to vegetarian diets and diabetes, comes from the Adventist mortality study. And this study enrolled over 24,000 people aged 30 to 89 years in 1960, living in California, and was already mentioned, Loma Linda is one of the blue zones, because the church group, the Adventist church group, recommend a vegetarian diet but do not require it. So you do see a big variety of diets in this church group. And let's see the pointer, or shall we do without it? There we go. Yeah. So this study looked at death certificates and diabetes. So it looked at incidence and it also looked at prevalence of diabetes and found that then the vegetarians had about a 60 to 90 lower odds ratio for diabetes, for overweight and for diabetes. Now, after they adjusted for weight, the risk was reduced, but still remained highly significant. So here we're looking at non-vegetarian males. Here we're looking at non-vegetarian females. And this study observed in particular that the difference was greatest in normal weight subjects, giving the idea that if you're obese, well, it doesn't make that much difference. This difference is greatest in normal weight people. Well, this was the first study, and after that, a number of studies, again, were looking at, is there a relationship between diabetes and vegetarianism and diabetes? The next Adventist study is the Adventist study, Health Study 2. This study was initiated by Dr. Fraser in 2002 to 2006, and this study had nearly 100,000 participants. First of all, there's a prevalence study, and then there's an incidence study. We're going to look at each of them. But in this study, for the first time, diets were divided up into vegans, lacto-ovo-vegetarian, pesco-vegetarian, semi-vegetarian, and non-vegetarians. So about half were non-vegetarians, 5% were vegans, and the others in between. And the categories follow what you would expect with these diets. So first of all, the prevalence study. Look at the difference in BMI between the vegans and the non-vegetarians. There's a whole 5 BMI units difference, really underscoring what Dr. Katz was just telling us, what a difference diet makes. And in relation to type 2 diabetes prevalence, the prevalence ranged from just under 3% to over 7%, following very closely the categories of BMI. This is the adjusted analysis, and here these odds ratios are adjusted for everything we could adjust in lifestyle, including sleep, including TV watching, including exercise, BMI, age, and ethnicity, and vegans had about half the odds ratio of type 2 diabetes. Lacto-ovo-vegetarians were close, both of these, and then showing a dose response as you lowered the amount of animal foods in the diet. Now let's go really far from Loma Linda to India, which is a part of the earth that has large numbers of vegetarians. This is the National Family Health Survey in India, and they followed some of the pattern of the Adventist study I just showed you. So here we have more than 150 adults. These are younger people between 20 and 50 enrolled about the same time that the Adventist health study started. And in this study, again, most are non-vegetarians, but there's a big group of lacto-vegetarians. So among men, semi-lacto-ovo or lacto-vegetarian diets were associated with nearly half the prevalence of diabetes, and in women, about a 30% reduction in diabetes prevalence. Now, it's interesting that in this study, there was no reduction in diabetes in vegans. And this is certainly a question as to why that may be so. What characterizes vegans in India, where there was no reduction in risk? And also in this study, there was no difference in BMI. The BMI was about 21 in all of the groups. Let's see if I can go back a moment, or could I go back? The bottom, okay. Try. Well, that's okay. So there seems to be a difference looking at Western populations than the Indian populations from the prevalence studies. So again, a BMI difference of about 5 units in the Western population, and no difference in the Indian population, but the average BMI in the Indian population was really low, just 21. So the same Adventist health study did an incidence study, and here we have participants that were followed for only 2 years. And this study looked at the difference between blacks in the study according to diet and non-blacks. So in blacks, and this is the first data we really have between on vegetarianism in blacks, again, a large proportion, over 60%, are non-vegetarians, and then we have the vegetarian groups. Could you show me how to go back? Is it, which one? Small right button? Okay, I just didn't press. So first the non-blacks, and then we'll compare to the blacks. Again, over 44% non-vegetarians in the non-blacks, and clearly reduced risks that kind of follow along with what we already saw in the prevalence studies. We all know prevalence studies are confounded because people may change their diet after they have a disease diagnosis. So the incidence study is very encouraging because it shows that, okay, with less confounding, you still see these considerable reductions in incidence of type 2 diabetes. In this study, it was not significant in the PESCO vegetarians. So on to the black subpopulation, very significant reductions in incidence of diabetes. Here's the vegan group. This is the lacto-ovo vegetarian group. And no significance in the PESCO or the semi-vegetarians. This could partly be because the groups are smaller, you have smaller numbers, but certainly the estimates go in the right direction. Okay, so this is approximately what we know about vegetarianism and the incidence of diabetes. What about the other side of the picture? What about eating meat and incidence or risk of diabetes? So again, back to the Adventist mortality study. This is now data that combined the mortality study with the health study. There were people who took part in both studies, both in the old one and in the new one. There was about 17 years of follow-up in this study, and among about 8,000 subjects, there were 500 incident diabetes cases in 17 years, and this study found that weekly or more meat intake was associated with weight gain and also nearly a 40% increased diabetes risk after control for weight and change in weight. So this is looking at the other side of the coin. What about meat eating and diabetes? The next studies come from the cohorts of health professionals, the very well-known Harvard cohorts, the nurses, two health studies, and the male health professional studies. And this is a great study because it looked at what you substitute for meat, both for unprocessed meat and for processed meat. On the left side, first we see the hazard ratios, and what's interesting about these, they're adjusted for the rest of the diet. So they're adjusted for all the usual confounders, but also for how the rest of your diet looks. And looking at servings of unprocessed red meat, servings of processed red meat and total red meat, we see a very clear significant increase in risk, both for unprocessed, processed, and total red meat, and this is per serving per day, unprocessed being 100 gram servings approximately and 50 grams of processed. And here's what you substitute for meat and the reduction in risk. So substituting nuts, dairy, whole grain, poultry, fish, and so forth for processed or unprocessed red meat, showing reductions in risk of diabetes. So this is one of the meta-analyses that was originally done, including these three Harvard studies, and also a number of other studies. And here I have it finally. Can see it a little better. So the risk ratio for unprocessed red meat and type 2 diabetes is an increase of about 19% per serving. So 100 gram serving, 19% increase in risk. And we see most of the estimates lie on the high risk end, except for the one study here that was done in Chinese women. That may indicate, again, there may be differences in the rest of the diet or in the study population or in the setting of the population that is not always consistent. And the next meta-analysis is for processed red meat, which has a very high relative risk, which brings us a 51% per serving, which brings us into the area of causality. Generally, when we talk about causality, we think that, okay, relative risk of maybe 1.1, 1.2 are low. Once we get over 1.5, we begin to think this could be a causal relationship. After these studies were published, we have the study of the Interact Consortium in Europe. So this includes a lot of European countries, various countries here. You can read about, see the different countries. But this study looked at total meat, red meat, processed meat, poultry also, where there was no increase in risk. So this is quite interesting that you're looking at different types of meat and clearly see an increase with red meat and with processed meats. On the bottom right is iron from red meat and heme iron, and again, there was an increase in risk there. The latest meta-analysis was published in 2013 by Feskins, and this really follows what we already saw: increase in risk with total meat, increased risk with red meat, and the highest increase in risk again with processed meat. So this includes the latest study. This is the relative risk for poultry, and this is for unprocessed red meat. So kind of processed red meat seems to stick out in these meta-analyses. Then the Harvard people went a step further and looked at change. Again, trying to build under the idea of causality, is there a difference if you change your meat consumption? Can you then see a difference in the incidence of type 2 diabetes? So this data comes from the three large cohorts of US men and women, the health professionals, and the nurses cohorts. And they followed up in this analysis I'm showing you here for 4 years. And we see that in the course of this time, where people started with a low meat intake and went to a high intake, there's a clear nearly doubling in risk of type 2 diabetes. However, if they started from a high intake of meat and went to a low intake of meat 4 years later, there was no significant reduction. So this could indicate that maybe some of the people who were high changed their diet for health reasons, or it could indicate that you need maybe a longer period of time to accumulate the benefits of changing your diet. But certainly, I think you'd agree with me that this part here is very significant, very interesting, and adds to the idea of causality. These associations were attenuated by weight gain, and they were strongest in the non-obese again. Now, I'm just showing you this very briefly, the latest data from the Harvard cohorts, where they decided to look at, well, how healthy is your vegetarian diet or your plant diet? And in this analysis, then, they did three dietary scores. The blue score is for a plant diet, so looking at vegetarian foods, but the green dietary score here is looking at healthy plant foods. So they took out potatoes, considered them unhealthy, took out sweetened drinks, took out sweets and desserts. So a stronger relationship if you look at healthy plant foods, and then in the analysis here, they're looking at deciles of unhealthy plant foods, showing that it's not just enough to eat plant foods, you need to eat the healthy plant foods, because if you don't, you may have an increase in risk. Well, what about these epidemiological data? How much can we really depend on them? We know that there's a lot of confounding. People who eat vegetarian diets or who eat more meat differ in all kinds of lifestyle characteristics. Meat eaters smoke more, drink more alcohol, eat more, have higher BMIs, have less physical activity, and statistical correction alone is not going to correct for all of these differences. We've learned that through the years. And one of the critics of the red meat diabetes hypothesis has written an article, I've never heard of this journal before, Meat Science, but it looks like it's a dependable journal, I guess. where he brought out data from that was published earlier from the AARP diet and health study. And yes, there is an increase in all-cause mortality with increasing red meat. There's an increase in cancer. There's an increase in cardiovascular disease. There's also an increase in accidental deaths, as you see. And there's also a huge increase in all other causes of death with increased meat eating. And those all others include diabetes. They also include liver disease and other diseases that we would not necessarily maybe associate with meat eating. And for white meat, as you see here, there's a decreased risk for everything. And there's also a decreased risk of accidental deaths. So can we build up our tower of causality better if we look at risk factors for type 2 diabetes? What about the association between vegetarian diets and risk factors? And of course, then we're thinking in a major way of metabolic syndrome. So from the Adventist Health Study, the data I showed you originally did not include blood tests. All of diabetes was self-reported. But in a subset of the Adventist Health Study participants, about 700 to 800 people, they do have data on metabolic risk factors. And what would you expect? I'd like you to think about it for a moment. Yes, there is a decrease in triglycerides with vegetarian diets. There is a decrease in blood pressure. There is a decrease in waist circumference. There is a decrease in BMI. But I don't think we're surprised that the one difference that was not significant is HDL cholesterol. So HDL cholesterol is not lower in vegetarians. Now, does that really matter? HDL cholesterol has lost a lot of popularity after Mendelian randomization studies have shown that there may not be causality between HDL cholesterol and cardiovascular disease. So who knows if that's important? It may be less important than we used to think. Probably not important at all when we see the difference in all the other risk factors. Well, back to metabolic syndrome. One of the major concerns we would have is weight changes. So again, back to the Harvard studies with Mazafarian, who looked at relationships between changes in food and drink consumption and weight changes in the Harvard cohorts. And we need to maybe do this a little faster, but again, you gain weight, no surprise, if you eat potato chips, fries, processed meats, and unprocessed meats, very clear, weight gain almost as bad as potatoes. And not just about as bad as drinking sugar-sweetened beverages. So plant-based diets seem to protect against weight gain. Do we have other data? Yes, we have great European data from the EPIC trials, which looked at annual weight change in regard to 100 kilocalories increase in total meat consumption. So just so you have the bottom line here, one steak a day is 2 kilo higher weight gain after 5 years. Maybe worth it. I don't think so. Okay. So what about the other risk factors? This is the meta-analysis of HDL cholesterol and triglyceride concentrations. And again, yes, HDL cholesterol concentrations seem to be lower with the vegetarian diet, and that's naturally because of less saturated fat. This is the triglyceride concentration, no change. So these are interventional studies mostly looking at effects of diet on risk factors, clear reductions in non-HDL and LDL cholesterol. This is a very interesting study done in vegans and omnivores where they looked at how quickly do you get rid of your chylomicron remnant particles. Now, I don't know if you've been following the data on lipid fractions and cardiovascular disease. I already told you that HDL is losing popularity. Well, what's gaining popularity are not just triglycerides, but particularly triglyceride remnant, chylomicron remnant particles. And these are lots of analyses done in Denmark by Nordiscore, showing the amazing parallels between risk related to remnant cholesterol LDL cholesterol, both for ischemic heart disease, myocardial infarction. Here we see where all-cause mortality is related to remnant cholesterol and not to LDL cholesterol. And this small study showed that vegans seem to get rid of their remnant cholesterol faster than omnivores. Blood pressure effects of vegetarian diets are clearly established, and this is the meta-analysis showing both reductions in systolic and diastolic blood pressure. Now, what about glucose parameters? There has been a meta-analysis showing slightly lower glucose in vegetarians, but the most interesting study was the one that looked at the genetic score. What kind of a predisposition do you have for type 2 diabetes, and what's the association then with between meat intake and fasting glucose? And there were actually relationships between processed meat intake and glucose, but they mostly disappeared after you controlled for BMI, and there was no difference in regard to your genetic score. The same with unprocessed red meat and glucose and insulin concentrations. They are significant, and that's important. They disappear, significance disappears when you control for BMI. But we need to keep in the back of our mind that BMI is an intermediate in the causal pathway between diet and diabetes. So it may not be correct for BMI. So finally, what are the mechanisms that have been looked at? On the one side, we have the synergistic effects of fruit, vegetables, whole grains, nuts, oils, legumes, all of the goodies that we've been talking about and will continue to be talking about, which probably reduce inflammation, reduce oxidative stress, reduce many of the mechanisms we talk about when we talk about incidence of type 2 diabetes. There's an intervention study, it's only a short-term study, that looked at increasing portions of fruit and vegetables and looking at insulin sensitivity. Now, it did not find a difference in insulin sensitivity as you increase portions, but again, we're looking at a short-term study, and we really don't know if we will ever have a study that will show a difference. Now, on the other side of the coin, we have what's wrong with red meat or what's wrong with processed meat. Well, of course, people think saturated fat. There are connections between saturated fat and insulin sensitivity. On the other hand, unprocessed red meat has more saturated fat than processed red meat, and the connection was stronger with processed red meat. And you'll remember the huge Women's Heart Initiative intervention study with a low-fat diet. It was designed to look at cardiovascular disease. They also looked at incidence of diabetes and did not find any connection with diabetes with the low-fat diet, saturated fat was reduced. Sodium has been brought up as a hypothesis, and there's at least one study where the authors said that, well, the connection was strongest with the sodium intake from unprocessed red meat. And this could help explain that processed red meat has a stronger relationship, but the connection sodium and diabetes is not as strong, maybe. Certainly, you would all know that advanced glycation end products have been discussed as a mechanism and may be a good mechanism. We have no endpoint studies to buttress that idea. For a long time, nitrates and nitrosamines have been suggested, especially in processed meat. Nitrosamines are known to be toxic to beta cells. Again, we do not have experimental evidence. Now, I've put heme iron in blue letters just to emphasize that that's a really good candidate for one of the problems with meat. Heme iron is connected with diabetes incidence in a lot of epidemiological studies. What we need is more experimental data. So what people have done are phlebotomy studies. If you do phlebotomies, you then have a lower incidence of diabetes, or you could ask, does that lower your insulin resistance or increase your insulin sensitivity? None of the phlebotomy studies are really good. They do not have sufficient control groups. They do not have good endpoints, some of them. There's not a single study that's really convincing. But this is certainly a study that any of you could think of, I'm sure, and do a nicely controlled phlebotomy study.
Serena.
Yes.
You have just 2 minutes
okay.
to finish.
Thank you. And the new markers that have been looked at in regard to meat are on the left-hand side, phosphatidylcholine and intestinal microbiota. We know that cholines interact with our intestinal microbiota, and there are mechanistic connections with type 2 diabetes. Endocrine disruptive chemicals have been mentioned. One of the most exciting molecules is a non-human sialic acid, and you see the whole name here, glycolyluraminic acid, which has been published lately to give increased inflammation. It's found in red meat and other animal foods. This is non-human, but it is found in humans, especially connected to getting this molecule from the diet, and it seems to increase inflammation. So my conclusion is, as we look at causality, we do have strong associations with vegetarianism, with BMI in Western populations. The connections with type 2 diabetes are not entirely consistent. They do differ according to setting, population, and type of meat. The strongest connections, associations, are with processed meat. BMI is a likely intermediate in the causal pathway, and I say, what does it really matter? If we do have a lower BMI with a vegetarian diet, that's enough for me. However, it could be interesting to know if meat is in itself harmful. Meat eating is confounded by lifestyle and other risks associated with meat eating. We really do not have experimental data, but addressing the idea of meat and type 2 diabetes, there are several plausible mechanisms that need more experimental evidence. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be here. And thank you, Hannah. Thank you, Cyril, for the invitation to present. I know that quite a lot goes into organizing a conference of this type, and it's wonderful to be able to be with you. When we are treating diabetes, what are we trying to accomplish? Basically, we want to protect the blood vessels. The blood vessels to the eyes or to the heart or to the kidneys or to the lower extremities. We want to reduce vascular risk. And so what I'd like to do is to present, first of all, some of our own data on all of these endpoints, but then try to put them into the context of all the other data that I've been able to find by anyone who's addressed these issues. In 2006, we published the first findings from an NIH-funded randomized controlled trial using a low-fat vegan diet versus a diet that followed the ADA guidelines at that time, which were very similar to today, reduce calories to try to lose weight and try to control carbohydrate intake to keep it fairly steady over time. It was a 22-week study with a one-year follow-up, and we had 99 participants. The first thing that was remarkable is in 22 weeks, we had no dropouts at all. And so when we looked at A1C, the red line is the ADA group, and they did reasonably well. They had a drop of about 0.4 on their A1C, and the vegans had about 1.0 that was not quite statistically significant. But those of you who use plant-based or other diets with diabetes know what's wrong with these data, which is that within a few days of beginning a diet, all of your patients treated with insulin or sulfonylureas are about to become hypoglycemic, and that means you're going to change their medications. So what you are seeing is a combination of the diet plus the changing medication milieu that they're in. So to reduce that confusion, let me now show you those individuals who made no medication changes in the first 22 weeks. And here we see something quite remarkable. The ADA group, which is the red line, had a nice drop of A1C of about 0.4, but the vegans had a drop of about 1.2, which is an enormous average drop in A1C. And then we followed them for an additional year, and again, the red line is the control group following the ADA diet, and they came back to baseline. I would argue that that was still a good experience for them to have lowered their A1C for some time, but with the people on the plant-based diet, they had a somewhat of a Nike curve, but never got back to their baseline in this time period. When people ask me, what's going on here? You brought in people, put them on a vegan diet, told them they could eat as many calories as they want, as many portions as they want, as much spaghetti and potatoes and rice as they wanted to. No limit on carbs. Their carb intake could go up, and they got better. Why? I'm going to argue that we take the focus off of carbohydrate and sugar and put it here in the cell. And I want to interpret some of the work that came from Gerald Schulman's work at Yale, where this is a cell, and glucose is a very good thing if it can get in the cell and power the cell in the same way as gasoline powers your car. But to do that, you need insulin. So the insulin key attaches to those red receptors and signals for the channels to allow the entrance of glucose into the cell. That's what's supposed to happen. And in type 2 diabetes, you have glucose, you have insulin, you have receptors. The binding is perfectly normal in most cases, almost every case. The problem is the signaling is not happening. And that, I am going to allege, has something to do with fat building up inside the cell, not belly fat, not thigh fat, but fat inside the cell. Of course, doctors hate words like fat because it has only three letters, so we'll call it intramyocellular lipid, but it's fat inside your cell, which changes remarkably little from what you had on your plate to what ends up inside the cell. And so on a plant-based diet, how much animal fat is there? There isn't any. And if I keep oils quite low, one could hypothesize that the fat content of that cell is going to change and insulin sensitivity starts to come back. And in a study we published in the American Journal of Medicine in 2005, we showed that indeed not only do people lose weight, but their insulin sensitivity does get measurably better with a plant-based diet. So a couple of years ago, we did a meta-analysis where we looked at every study on this. I'm focusing entirely on intervention trials, by the way. These are not observational studies, which Serena, I think, went over very, very well. But every intervention trial that we've seen shows the same effect from the middle line. A1C goes down. But there was one that just came out a couple of weeks ago looking at an Asian population. A group of researchers in Korea said, would it work here? And we follow a largely plant-based diet. We know what rice and noodles are. Would an intervention diet work well here? So they used a randomized trial of a vegan versus a conventional diet, 93 subjects. And what they showed was that the A1C dropped by about 0.5 in the vegan group versus 0.2 in the conventional group. And then when they looked at those who were most compliant, the difference was even more striking. A drop of 0.9 with the vegan diet and 0.3 with the conventional diet, and both quite significant. Okay, so looking beyond glycemia to body weight, when we tracked our participants out for a year and a half, we did not find a significant difference between the two diets in weight. But what is remarkable is that the conventional diet group does what every person with diabetes resolves to do when they walk out the door from the dietitian's office, where they've just been told, you're just too heavy, and I'm going to give you a menu that cuts 500 calories a day off of your diet. Follow this until you're at your ideal weight. And they feel somewhat discouraged by about Wednesday. And that group did not lose as much weight as the people who were allowed to eat as much spaghetti and pancakes as they wanted to. The vegans lose a little bit more than that, although the difference is not statistically significant. And when you look at every trial, the zero line is on the right here. Every trial that I can find that uses a plant-based diet as an intervention, whether it's done for weight loss or for something unrelated to weight, like rheumatoid arthritis, where weight loss is not a goal, you always see weight loss in effectively every study. Okay, so what do we know? We know that vegetarian and especially vegan diets lead to a healthier body weight. They do that without any intentional limit on calories or any intention to limit carbohydrate. Indeed, you can increase carbs if you wish. We have trials lasting at least 2 years. And why? I'm going to argue that it's not really very difficult to explain. When you're eating more fiber, your energy density of your foods goes down. When you're eating less fat, there's just not as many calories per spoonful. And our group showed a number of years ago that there is an increased thermic effect of food after the meal when people follow a vegan diet. Our study was small, and I think more replication could be used. But it looks like people following a vegan diet, just they eat less because fiber fills them up, and they have a somewhat better after-meal metabolism, possibly. Okay, looking at lipids, it won't surprise you, LDL drops on a plant-based diet. And we know this, you see this over and over again, total goes down, LDL goes down, and you're not eating saturated fat or effectively cholesterol, and the result is that your total and LDL will drop. On top of this, though, and citing some of David Jenkins' work, that there are a number of parts of the diet that may have an effect in addition by adding them to the diet. I'm speaking of his work with the portfolio diet. Soy, nuts, and other products may have that effect. The effect on triglycerides is variable. Sometimes they go up. Usually they go down over the long run. But I am going to guess that it relates to glycemic index. I'm guessing if it's sugary, high glycemic index foods, your triglycerides will go up. If it's beans you're eating, it's going to go down. At least that's my supposition. And then when we look at every trial ever done on with looking at total cholesterol, again, you see exactly what you'd expect. A plant-based diet makes your cholesterol fall. And same with LDL, it goes down. Okay, no big surprises. When we look at blood pressure, we see much the same thing, whether we're looking at systolic at the top or diastolic at the bottom. A plant-based diet will lower blood pressure, and that effect starts even before weight drops. And I'm going to suggest it is probably due to an increased potassium intake, but also reduced blood viscosity. You're not eating mozzarella sticks, so the saturated fat is not getting into the blood, increasing the viscosity of your blood. And your heart doesn't have to really work so hard to get the blood moving along through your arterial system. But even chicken eaters and even fish eaters are not even eating the same quality of fat that people following plant-based diets are when they're eating plants in a reasonably natural state. Okay? Dean Ornish put this together, I think, in a very nice way with his intervention trial published a couple of decades ago, where he looked at if you really put it together and follow a plant-based diet along with not smoking and modest exercise, a half-hour walk every day, not only do your arteries open up again, which has not been shown with any other diet, but also your likelihood of an MI or any other cardiac event goes way, way down. Okay, let me put a human face on this just briefly. Vance was a Washington, D.C. policeman who came into our research center. His father was dead by age 30. Vance was 31 when he was diagnosed with diabetes, and he came in to see us in his late 30s and said, to me, this disease means I'm going to go blind or I'm going to lose my leg. And he was randomized to the vegan diet, and over about a year, he lost 27 kilograms, 60 pounds. He stopped his diabetes medications. His A1C was 9.5 at the beginning, and it fell to 5.3 after about a year, which left us with a question, should we tell him that no clinic would diagnose him as having diabetes anymore? And that's become an easier question now that our bariatric surgeon friends have found ways to reverse diabetes rather routinely in people. And we've now been doing this with diet and have become more comfortable telling people that at the moment, your diabetes is gone. However, Velveeta is waiting right around the corner and your diabetes could come back. When I asked his permission to share his experience with you, he said, make sure you tell everyone that my erectile dysfunction went away too. So. Which, by the way, is something that we also see quite routinely. I'm not entirely sure that's a good thing, but we do see it. Nancy, similar diet change, lost 18 kilograms, stopped all of her diabetes medications. Her A1C fell from 8.3 to 6.8. She's still in the diabetic range, but I'm doing much, much better than she had been doing on medications alone. And interestingly enough, she noted that her joints no longer hurt, which is something that we're seeing quite frequently when people get especially the dairy products out of their diet. That's a whole other lecture, but I'm going to suggest a hypothesis that there's an inflammatory effect of certain proteins that can be associated then with certain autoimmune conditions, and we see this all the time. And it's a great compliance generator. When a person's joints don't hurt when they follow the diet and they kill them when they do follow the diet, it makes people want to stick with it. We recently started to run down this path of diabetic neuropathy. There was a study a number of years ago by Milton Crane looking at a vegan diet with painful neuropathy. It was a small study and uncontrolled, but found that a plant-based diet, along with an energy restriction and regular exercise, led to a complete remission of neuropathic pain. So I thought that was exciting. So I designed a trial where we brought in 34 people, and we did a crossover trial. And everyone had type 2 diabetes. Everyone had feet that hurt them or tingled at night. And the experimental group got a vegan diet, and both groups, the control group and the vegan diet, also took vitamin B12. And we did this because vitamin B12 can be a confounder. We wanted to see to make sure that everyone was similar with regard to B12. And because pain is very subjective, we measured galvanic skin response as an objective indicator of peripheral nerve function, which you can do on the hands and you can do it on the feet with a device called the pseudoscan. And what we showed is there was a difference in foot conductance. And then we looked at just how do you feel? Is your pain better? And in general, lower is better here. So the vegans generally did report that they were feeling better. And then we finally just said at the end, okay, are you a little better or a lot better? And the numbers were that for the vegan group, they were between 4 and 5, which is somewhat better or moderately better. And for the control group, they were somewhat lower than that. By the way, I should mention that whenever you do crossover trials with plant-based diets, it's a big challenge because quite often your patients refuse to go back from the healthy diet, and which is sort of confirmation, but it does drive you crazy when you're trying to respond to reviewers at journals. So what do we know? A plant-based diet improves A1C, it improves body weight, it improves lipids, makes blood pressure go down. Medication use will fall quite routinely and neuropathy gets better. We have convincing evidence of in randomized trials up to about 1.5 years and much longer for certain endpoints. And then many people, your colleagues will say, great, I'll believe it. No one's going to ever follow that diet. Please remind those people that they are scientists and there are data that goes to this point. And the fact that a person himself or herself may decide that cheese is just essential to life as we know it, if you are Vance and you're looking at going blind or losing your leg, maybe Velveeta isn't quite so attractive to you anymore. We did a study with Dean Ornish's patients in 1992 in women with dysmenorrhea, postmenopausal overweight women, people with diabetes, and people at the work site. And in every case using an intervention diet with a plant-based diet and quantitative scales of acceptability, we found that you just cannot show that a plant-based diet is any more difficult than any other intervention diet. And if you don't believe that's true, try going gluten-free for a week. That is punishment. Or try following a 500-calorie-a-day diet limitation for 2 weeks. Life, I got to tell you, is no longer worth living. But let me eat spaghetti and spinach lasagna, and it's really not hard at all. We did a study with Geico, the big car insurance company in the U.S., because they were interested in how is this going to work here at work. And so we did two trials. The second one was a 10-city trial in cities all across the U.S. with a variety of different cultures, including Macon, Georgia, and Chevy Chase, and Buffalo, New York. And what we showed, by the way, we learned that cafeteria managers sometimes need to learn a little bit about what vegan means. It was a bit of a challenge for some of them. But what we found was, at this point, no big surprise. When people joined this diet, which was two things, vegan foods in the cafeteria and a weekly support group where you could just share recipes and talk for 1 hour once a week on company time. Very simple, extremely inexpensive, and A1C among people with diabetes improved. And here was Hillary and Bruce, who at the beginning of the study, here they were at the a year later, and they wrote and said, really, you should provide this for everybody. It's just a great perk for them. Protein, calcium, vitamin B12, these are commonly discussed. Protein, I'm going to argue, is a complete non-issue on any varied plant-based diet. Calcium means eat green leafy vegetables and beans, and vitamin B12 should be supplemented, either as a multiple vitamin or B12 itself. We always teach in groups. Doctors say, I don't have time, and I agree, you don't have time. You don't do your x-rays, you don't do your urines, you don't do your labs, you shouldn't do nutrition teaching. Send people at 5:30 on Wednesday, and they and their reluctant spouse can sit in a group meeting, and what we do is we weigh everybody on their way in privately. We then discuss go around the room, how's it going? I had a great success this week, but I got a wedding next week, and they problem solve as a group. Then we provide some kind of presentation so they're learning each week, and then we give them some homework for the next week, and 60 minutes, they're gone. And at our medical center, we have five or six of these running every single week, and the patients just love it, and the doctors love it too, because they know that they don't have to beat their head against patient resistance. We have a model that allows that to just be dealt with automatically. Very, very simple. Okay, to begin a healthy diet, what I ask people to do is to take a week and just try the different possibilities. I never had a bean burrito. How is it? And then after you figure out what you would like for breakfast and lunch and dinner, then we do it for 3 weeks, all vegan all the time, and at the end of that time, see how you feel. And generally speaking, people feel good about it, and it's making sense, and they want to keep going. So at this point, you might be saying, all right, it's true. There's not a person on the planet who doesn't know that global climate change is real. And the person who's got the smallest carbon footprint is the person not eating animals at all. And to the extent that we don't have to raise feed grains and deal with the greenhouse gases that come from cows, that's better. And there's not a person on the planet who also doesn't know that animals really don't want to have their throats slit. Americans eat 1 million animals every hour. And there's not a person on the planet, I think, who doesn't realize that people following plant-based diets are generally healthier. So why don't we do it? I'm going to argue that it's because logic doesn't play much of a role in human diet changes. And you know this is true. How do we decide what we're going to have for dinner? It's not based on how much beta carotene or fiber I might need. It depends on culture. What did our parents eat, or the people who are with us? Or it depends on noise. What's in the media? What's on the restaurant menu? What the restaurateur is trying to push on us? And wishful thinking and money and addictions all play roles in all of these things. And logic can't compete very well. And you can experience this. And I'm going to argue this is good. If that sheep used logic to decide whether to run away from the wolf, he's going to be eaten alive. The others just go. And sometimes it's good to not think about things and just go with the crowd. Chimpanzees, same story. The little chimpanzee eats a berry that's not part of their culture. His aunt or sister is going to take it away. Go with the culture. And it makes a lot of sense to not use logic too much. And you can experience this when you're talking with somebody about diet. And the neurological explanation for resistance is as follows. The ideatron in the brain gives you the idea, maybe I should follow a plant-based diet. However, as soon as you have that idea, the famiglia stimulates the don't do it, Terry gland, to release ignorphins, which then say, no, wait, don't do that. My family doesn't go along with that at all. Plant-based, I don't think so. Where do you get your protein? And the person starts then coming up with rationalizations to defend their culture and their addictions. And the result is you have people really struggling to encourage people to improve their diets. This will not be on the test, by the way. But what we do find is that when we made really rather insistent changes like smoking a generation ago, even people like me who were busily lighting up their merit menthols eventually got the idea. And not too long after that, my friends who realized that a plant-based diet was a good idea before I did, they managed to convince me that they were right. And sooner or later, healthcare professionals, once we get our story straight, will be very good advocates to improve the rest of the world we live in. Thank you very much.
We've been thinking about ecological aspects of nutrition for some time, David in particular. I think it's a very important topic, one that the nutrition community is beginning to think a little more about. So please welcome David Jenkins.
Thank you, Cyril. I'd like to thank Hannah, Cyril, and John for having me here. I just want to go back to David, who talked about love as being one of the things that we need. Noting that he brought both his wife and his family here. My wife, fortunately, is here. I haven't got my daughters, but I think that would make the complete love part. I'm sure that's probably the most important thing in terms of diabetes reduction. I'm going to talk to you a little bit about some of the work we've been doing, not on diabetes, but on cholesterol, which I think is probably important because heart disease is a major feature of type 2 diabetes. I'm going to finish what will be a fairly light-hearted talk with some more serious points, inspired, I think, by Vlad Vuksin here, who gave me introduced me to Franz Kafka, who, with The Trial, I think was seminal in a lot of my thinking. And of course, it's appropriate that we're in his town. So I'm going through my conflicts of interest. These are many, many conflicts of interest of the various companies and organizations I've worked with to try and get plant foods produced and out into the marketplace. If there are those on the list that should be there, please let me know. I'm trying very hard to raise money. My wife said, don't dwell on this, everyone knows about it. But just to remind us, obviously, that obesity has been growing rapidly. Our previous speakers have spoken about this, and with it came diabetes. But there's been no major genetic difference that we can account for it. So are we going to then ascribe it to perhaps, as I think our speakers have already done, and all of you in the audience would probably agree with, lifestyle changes are probably the reason. David mentioned the Dietary Guidelines Advisory Committee, and I think that was tremendously impactful and important, I think, from my perspective. They had three diets. One of them was a vegetarian diet. I think that's the first time that one's seen North Americans being advised to eat a vegetarian diet, but it's one of the three. And the healthy American diet was less meat, and the Mediterranean diet, I think, as we know, is not a meat-rich diet. So I think the writing on the wall was there for the meat. And they also, so the advice was basically, let me go back. The advice was cut down on the red meat. And something that I think David paid a tribute to, pay attention to environmental and sustainability concerns. So I think that was a super guideline, and I think one that we could go along with. The reasons we've been hearing about are many reasons basically related to cancer and red meat. The evidence is on the writing's on the wall. Basically, red meat and total mortality, also a concern. Coronary heart disease and red meat we've heard about, and obviously diabetes, we've heard about. Serena gave a very good description of this, and this is one of the pieces of evidence. Unfortunately, the guidelines when they, after congressional review, were changed to eat more lean meat, and environmental concerns have no place in dietary guidelines, which I think was a shame. But we'll pass on that, I think. So let me say, what should we eat? And one of the things that I think fascinated me is basically, can we take our lead from evolution? Are our cousins, who perhaps have not had the benefit of making stone implements, fire, and then having the supermarket, their diets may be a little bit more pristine, and as they were before our clade started splitting 20 million years ago. So we thought, let's go back to this particular part of the evolutionary clade before we broke up into gorilla, chimpanzee, and human. And so we teamed up with Richard Carroll at the Bronx Zoo and the Wildlife Fund in his studies in the Central African Republic in a gorilla reserve where he didn't exactly have a dietitian living with a gorilla family for 7 days, which would have been the ideal. But he did have a lot of trackers with him, and they collected all the food the gorillas were eating over a 7 day period, as it were, sent them back to Toronto. We analyzed them, and we came up with the macronutrient profile. These are obviously the nature of the foods. This is one of the gentlemen concerned. So we put together what we thought was the simian diet and compared it with the standard therapeutic diet, as ATP3 step 2 diet, and the high-fiber, plant-based diet. I want to point out that to do credit to a simian diet, you'd have to have about 63 servings of fruit and vegetables a day. So not just 5 to 10. So this is something worth thinking about. But we often wonder why do we put on weight? Well, I mean, the daily food intake was 5.5 kilograms. It was about a tenth of the body weight for some of the people who we put on the study. So what's the effect of that? I don't have to. You can imagine 5.5. Satiety is a good one. You really don't get hungry, honestly. You don't get hungry. Obesity is very difficult. We had to force feed people to make sure on metabolic diets that they ate all the food that they were given and didn't lose weight, because they couldn't lose weight on the study. It took 8 hours, basically, during the day to eat all the food. So, I mean, you know, think of all the family meals, the socializing and the time to, you know, get rid of all the family problems you've got bringing up during the day. Probably the most important thing from our perspective was 1 kilogram of feces out. There was no constipation, which is a problem, obviously, on Western diets. Do any of you here approach that sort of level? Any hands up for maybe half a kilogram? Any half a kilogram people here? I see Jim's in the audience. I think he takes fiber with him when he travels. I know that. But perhaps not half a kilogram. Anyone at quarter of a kilogram then? A quarter of a kilogram? Thank you. I've got a few takers for quarter of a kilogram. Good, that's a good level. Probably about 150 to 200 is a good sort of amount to put out. So 1 kilogram is really pushing it, as they say. But even more important, 1 gram of bile acids lost to the feces. It's a cholestyramine-like effect. It's a drug-like effect in terms of taking out bile acids in the feces. So that was useful. So it's no surprise to you if I was to say that on a step two diet, a therapeutic diet, you've got about a 10%, 5 to 10% reduction in LDL cholesterol in the group of volunteers over a two-week period. This is a short study. But one got a 35% reduction in LDL cholesterol on this very primitive diet. So what one's saying is that because we have changed from being the sort of simian type feeder to being a modern feeder, we probably do need a statin in general. So I think that's the reason why we take statins, and diabetes, people with diabetes are obviously more prone to cardiovascular disease, so this becomes a major issue. So interestingly, the main features probably of this diet were basically the vegetable protein, the fiber. I want to say the plant sterols too. 1 gram of plant sterols a day was what was analyzed, and obviously the nuts. Interestingly, this is exactly what the FDA have allowed for cardiovascular risk health claims. Vegetable proteins, soy, for example, viscous fibers, beta-glucan, barley, psyllium, plant sterols, and nuts, all have got cardiovascular health claims, according to the FDA. So if you're a manufacturer and you've got adequate amounts, you can put that on the package. Sorry, I'm trying to change, but it won't go. It seems to stick. So we thought, well, why not? Let's just do a metabolic study and feed people diets where we're not feeding the simian diet, but adequate amounts of viscous fiber, vegetable proteins, plant cereals, and almonds. We did that, and 5% each, 10% for a low saturated fat cholesterol diet, you should get 30% LDL reduction. You can buy the foods from supermarkets. We didn't expect the patients in this study to buy them. We bought them ourselves. Viscous fibers, nuts, oats, barley, psyllium, legumes, eggplant and okra. I don't know whether you eat eggplant and okra, but these are worth considering. Vegetable proteins, tofu, soy, etc., and plant sterols in a margarine. What we saw was what you'd predict, the control diet, the therapeutic diet, about 10%, and then the dietary portfolio, about 30%, and similar to 20 milligrams of lovastatin, which was given in the same group of individuals, so both about a 30% 30+% reduction. And interestingly, also reductions in C-reactive protein, the inflammatory biomarker. Where have I gone? I'm trying to go back. Not a big difference between the portfolio and the statin and the control diet, no change. We know statins tend to lower CRP, so that was no surprise, but we don't normally find that cholesterol-lowering diets lower CRP as a marker, perhaps, those are 1 month studies. On longer term studies, we've shown about half the effect when people have to buy their food. This is a 6 month study, but in individuals, we also see a tendency for a reduction in blood pressure. Neil Barnard mentioned that. Neil mentioned this in relation to vegetarian diets. The effects are obviously nothing like you'd get on a statin diet. Sorry, this seems to be going backwards. Wow. Am I wasting time? Sorry. How am I for time?
You're okay.
Seven minutes. Sorry?
Seven minutes.
7 minutes. I better hurry. So I won't go into too much detail. I will hurry along to the Kafka-esque part of the trial. Obviously, this is not a DASH-type effect, but it was significant. And these people had blood pressures of 180 over 70. So, 117 over 80. So the big reductions were not expected. We were fortunate. Scott Grundy took this up in the 2004 update of ATP3. The Canadian Cardiovascular Society guidelines use the portfolio diet, and there's a nice, if I can get to it, there's a nice one by Heart UK, which also has got a website with the dietary portfolio on it, pretty one. And the European Atherosclerosis Society has got the portfolio diet under nutraceutical approaches. So I think So do plant foods actually, they certainly reduce lipids, C-reactive protein, blood pressure, what about CVD risk? And I think, we've got Geordie here and Amelia. Both from PREDIMED, and I think PREDIMED did everyone a service by demonstrating that with a Mediterranean diet, either with olive oil or nuts, one could get a 30% reduction in CVD outcomes. So I think I think we could expect to see good outcomes from this sort of approach. So to conclude quickly, plant-based diets and plant food components are potentially useful in the control of CHD risk factors, obviously are very important for diabetes. Many small changes may together have a significant effect on CHD risk reduction, and the availability and palatability of foods, I think, as Neil alluded to, is of key importance. So where does the food come from? Is this what you imagine? Is this where your food comes from? Is this the sort of bucolic surroundings? Or does your food come from this sort of a place? And Tony Weiss of University of Western Ontario believes that we're consuming vast amounts of territory where we produce a very limited number of crops, which we tend to feed then, passage them through the animal world, and then eat the output. And so it's what we call industrial farming, and that's in fact where we are right now. Antibiotics are used as they have to be, because under these crowded conditions, one gets infection. If one wants to maximize growth and feed efficiency, then one uses antibiotics. There is a problem with antibiotic use. One has these large lagoons full of the manure with antibiotic resistant bacteria actually in these particular lagoons. So major problem here. In Canada, we recently had a concern where pig farming and dairy farming, intensive husbandry, resulted in E. coli, resistant E. coli, causing hemolytic uremic syndrome that killed 7 people and put 2,000 people with stays in hospital. So I think these are part of the feeding system that we've got relates to animal produce. CO2 and methane production, livestock, cattle are said to account for 14% of global greenhouse gases with global warming. Obviously, we're worried about global warming, but I want to tell you something interesting that relates to diabetes. Gillian Booth and Joel Ray at St. Mike's, the hospital that I'm at in Toronto, looked at the records for those who had gestational diabetes, and they looked at the temperature, ambient temperatures 1 month before the diagnosis of gestational diabetes in the Ontario group over a period of 10 years. And what they were able to plot quite spectacularly was as the ambient temperature increased, so the incidence of gestational diabetes increased. So it seems to be that there are stresses related to heat, and these are not big changes in temperature. These are temperatures that you can find in Ontario, which goes from sort of 0 to 22 in terms of ambient temperature. So these are another feature, if you like, of global warming. I'm trying to get past that one. Also, birds, pigs, H1N1 influenza, this was a problem. Certainly we had an epidemic in 2009, but perhaps the big epidemic in terms of influenza was the 1918-1919. 50 to 100 million people died in that epidemic, and 2 to 5% of the world's population died. It was called Spanish flu, but that was a misnomer. It was just because the Spanish reported it and the Allies in the war didn't, because they didn't want to depress the population. That's a picture of a US base that was turned into a flu casualty hospital, and that's the 1918 picture. More respiratory problems have come our way from carnivory. This is the civet cat, looks very like a raccoon to us from North America. The Chinese use civet cats as food, butcher them on the family table. The coronavirus gave rise to SARS, so a major concern. Immunodeficiency viruses, there's a simian immunodeficiency virus that infects primates. The bushmeat trade probably spread that to us and gave us AIDS. So this is the bushmeat trade. So why not eat fish? Well, frankly, you're out of luck. These are the decline in fish stocks, about 30% by 2005. And by 2050, we're going to be out of fish stocks. So I think time is running out. I think my time is running out too. So it's basically, we're small plant foods have a major role in preventing chronic disease. Effects may be small individually, but collectively they may be drug-like. Failure to direct humans towards plant-based diets has major health, environmental, and humanitarian consequences. And basically, a comprehensive strategy of dietary change, agricultural diversification, technological innovation, and global family planning are urgently required if we're not already too late to avoid the tipping point. Thank you.
It's my pleasure to introduce the last speaker of our session, Effie Vigeluk from Canada, and she will present her abstract, "Vegetarian Diets Improve Glycemic Control in Diabetes, a Systematic Review and Meta-Analysis of Randomized Clinical Controlled Trials."
Hello, everyone. So today I will be discussing the results of a systematic review and meta-analysis of randomized controlled trials looking at the effect of vegetarian diets on glycemic control in individuals with diabetes. And this study was commissioned by the DNSG for guideline development. So I will first start out with a bit of background information, and I'll quickly go through it as many of the speakers have already gone over most of it, if not all of it. As most of us are aware, diabetes prevalence is increasing globally, and this map from the International Diabetes Federation shows the prevalence rates in various regions of the world, and so the purple regions show the highest prevalence rates, and so you can see that both developed and developing countries are affected. And as time goes on, it is expected that the number of people with diabetes is expected to continue to increase. Therefore, it's imperative that we implement effective strategies for diabetes prevention and management. And as we all know, diet and lifestyle modification has been shown to play a large role in this, specifically vegetarian and vegan dietary patterns, which are high in fruits and vegetables, pulses, soy and soy products, and nuts have been shown to have a wide range of health benefits. In prospective cohort studies, as we've already seen from Serena Tonstad's presentation, vegetarian and vegan diets have been shown to lower the risk of obesity, diabetes, cardiovascular disease, and cancer, to name a few. From controlled trials, vegetarian and vegan diets have also been shown to have beneficial effects on a wide range of clinical outcomes. Just in the last 2 years, there have been several systematic reviews and meta-analyses of controlled trials, majority of which included randomized controlled trials that have looked at various clinical outcomes. And so I've summarized them here in this figure. And so the red diamonds show the pooled effect estimate for each clinical outcome from each systematic review and meta-analysis. And so you can see that vegetarian and vegan diets have been shown to significantly lower hemoglobin A1C, various lipid outcomes, including LDL and non-HDL cholesterol, body weight, as well as blood pressure. And I also just wanted to very briefly mention some of the other benefits that have been touched on, is that vegetarian and vegan diets can help protect the environment, the welfare of animals, as well as they're economical. So given all these health benefits, what do the Diabetes Association guidelines say with respect to vegetarian and vegan diets? The Canadian Diabetes Association recommends vegetarian or vegan dietary patterns as one of the dietary patterns that people with type 2 diabetes can use to improve glycemic control, and that received an evidence rating of B on a scale of A to D. The American Diabetes Association also recommends a vegetarian and vegan dietary pattern as one of the dietary patterns that are acceptable for the management of diabetes, and this received an evidence rating of E on a scale of A to E. And the European Association for Study of Diabetes has not made any specific recommendations for following a vegetarian or vegan diet for the management of diabetes. And so all of this information really led to the rationale of this current project, which was to synthesize the evidence on which recommendations are based for the metabolic benefits of vegetarian and vegan diets in individuals with diabetes, specifically on glycemic control outcomes. So the objective was to pool the effect of vegetarian and vegan diets on glycemic control in individuals with diabetes from randomized controlled trials. And this was part of a larger project that looked at other cardiometabolic endpoints such as lipids, adiposity, as well as blood pressure, for which I will be showing the preliminary results later on in the presentation. So to get to the methods, so the conduct of the systematic review and meta-analysis followed the Cochrane Handbook for Systematic Reviews of Interventions and the PRISMA guidelines. We searched three different databases as well as manual searches. We registered our study on clinicaltrials.gov, and our search terms followed the PICO framework. So we had search terms specific for a population of interest, which was individuals with diabetes. For the intervention of interest, which was vegetarian and vegan diets, the comparison, which was non-vegetarian or vegan diets, and our outcome of interest, which was glycemic control. And we were specifically interested in hemoglobin A1C, fasting glucose, and fasting insulin. And these were the eligibility criteria for a study to be included in our meta-analysis. So if it was a randomized controlled trial conducted in humans with a follow-up rate greater than or equal to 3 weeks, with a vegetarian or vegan diet in the intervention arm and a suitable control arm that consisted of a non-vegetarian or vegan diet, as well as viable outcome data. It was included in our systematic review and meta-analysis, and if it did not, it was excluded. So this is just how we screen studies once we've identified them from our database search. So first we do a title and abstract review, and if we can see that they don't meet our eligibility criteria by just reading the title and abstract, they get excluded from our meta-analysis. The remaining studies undergo a full article review. And again, if they don't meet our eligibility criteria, we exclude them, which leaves us with the final studies included in our systematic review and meta-analysis. And once we have our final list of studies, we extract data from them. So we use something called a proforma, and we basically extract the following information to your left. We also do a risk of bias assessment using the Cochrane risk of bias tool, for which we assess the risk of bias using the following five domains listed here. And for our statistical analyses, so for the primary pooled analyses, we use a generic inverse variance method using random effects models reported as mean differences in 95% confidence intervals. For our heterogeneity analyses, the significance is tested by Cochrane skew with quantification bias squared, and all of these are done on a review manager. We also do a priori subgroup analyses for the following subgroups listed here, as well as publication bias analyses using funnel plots and Eggers and Beck's tests, and all of these are done on Stata software. And once we've completed our systematic review and meta-analysis, we do a quality of evidence assessment using the GRADE tool, which allows us to classify the quality of the evidence into one of four levels: high, moderate, low, or very low. And so randomized controlled trials start off as being categorized into a high level of evidence. And then by considering the following five factors here, we can rate down the level of evidence, as well as subsequently rate up by considering the following three factors here listed to your right. So now to get to the results. So after doing our database search, we identified over 2,000 reports, majority of which were excluded based on title and abstract, which left us with 49 reports reviewed in full. Again, majority were excluded, which left us with 8 trials that were included in the meta-analysis with 376 individuals. And these are just the summary of the trial characteristics. So majority of the median age was around 56, so middle-aged participants. They were overweight and obese, had type 2 diabetes, and the follow-up duration, the median was 12 weeks, and half of them were conducted in the United States. So for the primary pooled analysis for hemoglobin A1C, we found a significant lowering, which is a clinically significant lowering with 0% heterogeneity. Similarly, for fasting glucose, we found a significant reduction with 0% heterogeneity. And for fasting insulin, there was only one trial, so we don't have a forest plot for this, but it did show a significant lowering. And we also, because we had less than 10 studies, we did not conduct subgroup or publication bias analyses. So now for the GRADE assessment. So both hemoglobin A1C and fasting glucose received a moderate quality of evidence rating, and this was due to both of them having serious imprecision in the pooled effect estimate. And like I said, I would show the preliminary findings for the other cardiometabolic risk factors. So these are, again, the pooled effect estimates for each of the cardiometabolic risk factors. So there was no significant effect on any of the lipid outcomes, but as you can see, LDL cholesterol came pretty close, and so did non-HDL cholesterol. There was significant lowering in body weight, BMI, and waist circumference, and no effect on blood pressure. So just to summarize, so pooled analyses of 8 trials in individuals with diabetes show that following a vegetarian or vegan diet over a median duration of 12 weeks significantly reduces hemoglobin A1C and fasting glucose levels. Reductions seen in hemoglobin A1C may be clinically significant. The overall quality of the evidence was graded as moderate quality for hemoglobin A1C and fasting glucose owing to serious imprecision in the pooled effect estimates. Due to the small number of trials included, we were not able to perform subgroup and publication bias analyses. So based on the limitations, there's obviously a need for longer and larger trials. And that concludes my presentation. I'd just like to acknowledge the Toronto 3D Knowledge Synthesis and Clinical Trials Group, as well as our funding sources. Thank you.
You know, I'm in very august company here, so one is a bit reluctant to be the first to answer any of the questions. I love the discussions. The brain slide, Neil, is pure genius. I love that. So, you know, I don't think there, if you're looking for RCT data to indicate what happens if you take people after 50, 60, 70, 80 modify their protein intake, what happens to sarcopenia, what happens to functional measures, what happens to cardiometabolic measures, I'm not aware of any such data. To the best of my knowledge, we can only answer from altitude. I'm aware of no epidemiologic indication that the people in the blue zones who routinely live to be 100 and enjoy incredible vitality willfully alter their dietary patterns as they age, because their dietary patterns are largely dictated by culture. They eat with family, so they eat pretty consistently throughout their lifetime. So I think one answer to the question is, if you have a healthy diet throughout a lifetime, it seems to foster vitality and longevity. And I think, to address your question, vitality in longevity. So those latter decades of life, they remain vital, incredibly active. I don't know if you've ever seen Dan Buettner present, but one of the beauties of his perspective is he's not an epidemiologist, he's not a scientist, he's an explorer. So he puts a human face on this, and you see the images of these people who are splitting wood at age 102. They're not sarcopenic. They remain active, and they eat the traditional diet. The other thing that's probably worth mentioning is, although we fret a lot about the adequacy of protein quantity and quality on a vegan diet, and here I'd happily defer to Neil or David or anyone else up here, we easily can meet our requirements for protein. And the combination of getting ample protein and being physically active is a robust defense against sarcopenia, and animal protein, to the best of my knowledge, is simply not required.
I just like to say that I think David's done a very good job, and I think what he's saying is, if you're taking a really good diet anyway, and I think Andrew said that's right, but some of the diets, the sort of toast and tea diet, obviously that was once for the aged, is obviously not a good diet. So I think we're agreeing that an adequate protein intake in old age is obviously very important, and the since we're super adequate most of the lifespan now. If one just maintains a good diet, protein intake, which one can do from plant-based foods, then I think one's in good shape.
We should have just said that the average age up here is 106, and we'll arm wrestle you afterwards.
I might just add one thing. I think it's a great question. We're used to thinking of protein as being sort of its own group, and the MyPlate diagram, I think, reinforced this unfortunate view that you can have fruits and vegetables and grains, which we all know have no protein at all, so you have to have a protein group to supply it. But protein and nutrition is a little bit like air. You need oxygen. You don't have to seek it out. It's part of air. There's also carbon dioxide and nitrogen and so forth. So if you are a bull and you're eating nothing but vegetable matter, you're not really worried about an absence of protein. And if you send a sprig of broccoli to the lab, they'll say, holy cow, this is one-third protein. And what dictates how much protein you get is how much you're eating of these foods. And that's true of beans and the whole legume group. It's true of the vegetable group. It's true of the grain group. They have lots of protein. And somehow it's become an unfortunate selling point. And I really think now is, I remember Dennis Burkett, when I was interviewing him years ago, he stopped me in a discussion. He said, Neil, two words, forget protein. And I thought, you're right about that. So.
David, if I remember correctly, I think our simian diet had about 16% protein. It was in that range.
The simian diet, you're right, so it's actually much higher than that.
Is it closer to 20?
Closer to 20.
Yeah, so it really wasn't a concern. That's just the, well, you David presented that, just fruits and vegetables, really no protein sources that we think about. So it answers your sort of response to your question or your comments. Should we move on? Another question.
What about children's? Are there any special recommendations for this group in terms of vega?
The same basic impression. I think David and I throughout, and Neil at the end, emphasized the issue of culture. And you know, if you look at the compositional elements of lifestyle as medicine, it's not just a good diet of minimally processed, mostly or exclusively plant foods, but it's social interactions around those foods. People throughout the world who derive the greatest benefits from food are typically eating that food as part of a culture and routinely eating it with their families. And you know, again, I don't think we've got all of the randomized data we might like. And I think one of the things this panel did exceptionally well was to explore the subtleties related to the hierarchy of evidence, where we do and we don't have randomized trials to look specifically at causality and mechanism. But from altitude, we know that whole populations enjoying excellent health are raising their children on those same lifestyle patterns, on those same dietary patterns. There have been specific examinations about developmental milestones in children on vegetarian and vegan diets. The rate over the first couple of years of life can vary, but at the end of 2 years, vegetarian and vegan children are in no way behind. Obviously, they have less signs of early obesity and overweight. There are associations between vegetarian and vegan diets in childhood and a higher IQ. Now, you know, whether that's because the smarter families have read the writing on the wall and are putting their kids on vegetarian and vegan diets, or because there's actually a causal relationship there, I don't know. But to the best of my knowledge, there are no concerns about developmental problems. In general, official recommendations are against restricting fat intake for the first couple of years of life. If anyone up here could comment specifically about cholesterol intake in children, obviously there's cholesterol in breast milk, and so vegetarian and vegan children don't start out vegetarian and vegan. They consume dairy products if they're well fed, but the dairy products come from their mother. So they start out with animal food, but you know, it's within the family, so there's an adequate supply of fat and cholesterol. And then at weaning, if breastfeeding goes on long enough, there's no problem removing those things. But further comments there? Neil, have you got more on this topic?
Just to reinforce what you said, breastfeeding has sometimes been regarded as somehow optional or a choice. It's an essential part of reproduction, and really should be encouraged, despite the fact that it's sometimes uncomfortable or doesn't, you know, make your boss happy or something like that. We've got to work this out. You know, kids need to be breastfed, period. And they don't need milk from any other species at any point in life. I think it's important not just to look at, is it safe to be a vegetarian or a vegan? I would look at it the other way. What are the risks of, say, introduction of dairy products, cow protein and cow fat, into an infant's life? And we do know that it greatly increases the risk of type 1 diabetes and other issues as well. And then when we start increasing muscle tissue into their diet, meaning a non-vegetarian diet, you see other risks rising as well. So I think the question isn't, is a plant-based diet safe, but really when should it start? And the answer, I'd say, is conception, probably, or maybe somewhat before conception.
Well, I think, like David said, it's within a cultural context. So vegetarian families usually know that you have to have high energy density for children. You give them nuts, oils, avocado, and make sure they have enough fat. And you need to think about B12 and the vegans, of course, and vitamin D.
Vlad.
Yeah, I have something. I have a comment. I'm vegetarian at home. I only eat meat at conference because it's free. Yeah, I mean, I'll tell you, Neil, you like these cases. If you put my picture, you didn't have time. I kind of start doing something kind of my own, lot of vegetarian thing and all this kind of thing. You know what? In about 6 months, I got peripheral neuropathy. So what would be your recommendation for people with diabetes who are more thin than me, because I'm not drug addict, not yet, not diabetic, not alcoholic? And I developed in about 6 months, even Alexander is my witness, even eating soya something with some B12, not every day, you know, took me like I don't know how many months to take supplement. So anyway, so is it good to be vegetarian and not in diabetes and not to tell people to take B12? But B12, David told me, is not too good to have too much of B12 supplements. So okay. What is your
question? All right. So if I understand right, the question is, what about B12?
I don't understand.
B12 is an important issue, and I'm glad you raised it. It's not made by animals, and it is not, of course, made by plants. B12 is made by bacteria. And you will hear people hypothesize that before the era of modern hygiene, that the bacteria on the soil, in plants we might pull out, on leaves, on our fingers, in our teeth, or whatever, might produce the 2.4 micrograms that you need for healthy nerves and healthy blood. But I have to say, I find those sources are not reliable now, if they ever were. And so I think the only sensible thing is to supplement B12. And so if we're talking about children, a healthy diet is vegetables and fruits and whole grains and legumes plus B12, which can be a Flintstones vitamin or whatever it is. And for an adult, it's the adult version of the same thing. I have seen a lot of people who have followed plant-based diets for a long time without supplementing, which I think is a mistake, and without developing any kind of symptoms. But I encourage people to not risk that. It's, to my knowledge, there's no risk to high doses of B12. And by the way, for people who say, well, wait a minute, your diet should be natural, we don't live in nature anymore in the same way as you have to supplement vitamin D, which you shouldn't have to do because we should be getting sun, but we're using sunscreens and staying indoors, and if that's modern life, then we supplement that too.
I didn't understand your question. You didn't answer my question. I didn't understand your answer. I was asking mainly about type 2 diabetes, and there are elderly people who need more B12 as well. And if you put them on vegetarian diet, what would be advice with respect to B12?
Well, the B12 issue doesn't have anything to do with a vegetarian diet. If you are an omnivore who is eating animal products, you could still become low in vitamin B12. And that can be due to an absence of stomach acid, which is required to cleave the B12 off the protein. It could be due to the metformin you're taking. It could be due to something else. And most of the people in hematology clinics who are marginal in B12 are not vegans. These are people who have other metabolic issues. So I would, if I'm understanding correctly, I would strongly encourage all clinicians to assess B12 levels and to treat it quite carefully, because there are lots of ways of running low, and it's the easiest thing in the world to treat and to prevent deficiencies. Vegans have it easy because they know they've got a supplement.
Can I just say, Vlad? Vlad and I have discussed this at great length. I'm always concerned with supplements in general because people often overdo them. And certainly we've got some Scandinavian, Norwegian studies looking at supplementation which have not shown good results. But we can measure. So I do think it's very worthwhile that people should, just as you'd have a measurement for anything, have a measurement of your B12 and then supplement.
Can I just, David Katz?
Right, we have to move on.
No, I have just 10 more minutes.
One last question over there.
So just a quick question on the last talk. It was very interesting. I want a clarification. You said there was no effect on blood pressure, but actually it looks like there was an increase in blood pressure. Can you clarify that?
I mean, it was going in the direction of an increase, but it wasn't a significant increase in blood pressure. You could see that the confidence intervals were crossing the line of unity, so we can't confirm that there is an increase in blood pressure. I think there's more studies that are needed to confirm this, so.
Thank you very much for the discussion.